Okay, so first of all, hello everybody, and welcome to this webinar. My name is Perry, and I'm a research assistant here at the Canadian Research Data Center Network. And I'd like to welcome you all on behalf of the CRDCN. We are very thrilled to launch this partnership with the journal Canadian Public Policy with this first webinar, which is titled COVID-19 and School Closures. I'm going to let Michael Veal, who is our principal investigator for our network, as well as an editor for the journal Canadian Public Policy, to introduce our panelists. So Mike, you can take it from here.
Okay, welcome. And I won't take long for introductions. I will note that the presentations will be in English, but we will have an extended question period, and you can then ask questions in English or French. Vous pouvez poser vos questions en français ou en anglais. Both of these papers are rooted in articles that are in the Journal of the Journal Canadian Public Policy. The first, Pandemic School Closures May Increase Inequality in Test Scores, by Catherine Haeck and Pierre Lefebvre. Catherine is a professor in the Department of Economics at the Université du Québec et Montréal, and her paper with Pierre is in the March 2021 issue, and she will be presenting today. And the second paper, COVID and the Economic Importance of In-Person K-12 Schooling, by David Green, Ali Karimirad, Gaëlle Simard-Duplain, and Henry Hsu, is forthcoming in the June issue of Canadian Public Policy. And Gaëlle will be presenting today. She is a postdoctoral research at the Center for Innovative Data in Economic Research at the University of British Columbia. So we will begin with Catherine, please.
Thank you. Thank you so much for the invitation. So I'll just share my screen. Give me a second there. So, and then I'll do full screen mode. So by now you should see my screen full screen mode. So hopefully it's all good. So thank you so much for having me here. So I'll do a presentation that actually covers the paper we published in Canadian Public Policy last summer, but also another paper we published in Canadian Public Policy, and a glimpse of something coming up in like 15 minutes. So hopefully stay with me. I'm gonna try to do this in 15 minutes. So first, usual disclaimer, this work is ours. We have a lot of partners that we would like to thank, but none of the things we will be saying are supported by our partner. It's all our work and we're responsible for it. So, but we have many people, many grant agencies that have allowed this work. So we'd like to thank them, and especially the CRDCN. So what happens when we close schools? Obviously, it's clear that we cause learning interruptions, and we also cause work disruptions. So both happen at the same time. But the extent to which these disruptions will affect people will depend on the vulnerability of people. And this is what I will try to show you, both in trying to see what happens in terms of learning and what happens to parents, if I get the time in the last 2 minutes of my presentation. So let's start with youth learning inequalities. So first, when the pandemic first started in the spring, we had no idea what we were getting into, and the first school closure lasted for about 3.2 months. So the work we did in the summer, and that was published in Canadian Public Policy, was trying to get a sense of how big would be the impact of these school closures on learning for children. So at the time, we didn't have data on children's learning. The school had been closed. There were no standardized tests being run. There still are none in most provinces. So we really had to rely on the literature to try to get a sense of what was happening. So virtual schooling was limited and unequal across the country. So in our estimate, we don't take into account the fact that in some provinces, virtual schooling was probably better done than in other provinces. We're really trying to get a sense of what happened when you close down school for 3.2 months. So we are focusing here our presentation on 15 years old, so maybe this one here, but we have to keep in mind that this affected all children and it's likely to have impact into the future, and the literature does suggest that it will have long-lasting impact. So why is this article called potential impact and not actual impact? Well, because in Canada, we don't have data on children and youth that is collected on a systematic basis that allows us to capture what has happened during the pandemic. So we used to have a really nice survey called the National Longitudinal Survey of Children and Youth that was run every 2 years. So if we had been in that world, by now we would have had collected data and we'd be having a sense of what was going on. But still, as of today, there are no initiative, pan-Canadian initiative, that are being run at the moment. We are doing efforts into that direction, but it's still not happening yet. So right now, it is impossible to measure the actual impact of the pandemic on children's learning, well-being, and family functioning using representative high-quality data across Canada. So our approach was to try to get a sense of current learning inequalities in our country, to see how stable these were, and then to document the impact of school interruption using data and article that were themselves using good, high quality representative data. So what we do first to measure the inequalities in our country is that we use PISA data. So we use the micro data from PISA. This is a survey that's run every 3 years. There are 7 cycles that have been completed. And every time there is a cycle, there is one main domain, even if in every cycle, all 3 domains will be surveyed. So in 2000, the main PISA survey was about reading. In 2003, it was in math. In 2006, it was in science. And then it starts again, 2009, reading, 2012, math, et cetera, et cetera. But every single time there is a math questionnaire, a science questionnaire, a reading questionnaire, but they will be shorter. But this affects the way in which we approach the data. So this offers us a really good opportunity to first measure our own inequality across the country by province, look at how we're doing, and then benchmark ourselves against other countries. So in this presentation, for the sake of keeping it short, I will focus on math, but keep in mind that if I had shown the results in reading and science, the results would have been very similar. My choice of mathematics is really related to other work I'm doing in numeracy that really shows that numeracy skills are extremely correlated with future income. So it's really a good measure of the potential to have a higher income in life. So in order for everyone attending to be able to understand the numbers I'm talking about, let's first set some numbers in your head. So Canada's score in PISA is typically around 520 points. So the average score in the OECD is 500, but Canada is a bit higher and it's one of the leading countries in this measure. A 40 point difference is considered by the OECD the equivalent of 1 year of education. So if you have a student with 520 points on the score and another student with 480 points, so they have a 40 point differences, so for 480 to 520, they will be considered as having a one year gap in learning. So 40 points, 1 year of education. The standard deviation of the distribution of the scores in PISA ranges between 90 to 100. So you can always interpret everything I'm saying in terms of standard deviation if you prefer that. So a move of one standard deviation for people not familiar with this this wording, I guess, in English, it would be a move from the 50th percentile rank to the 84th percentile rank. So you're moving from the middle to the 84th rank. So you can think of it in many ways. I kind of like the 40 points. So keep in mind the 40 points, 1 year of education. This will give you a good idea of the differences that I will show you later. So first, let's start with learning inequalities in Canada using PISA. So here, stay with me for a second. So here, what this graph shows you, there's one box for each province. The red dot shows you the average score of children at the very top of their score distribution. And you should look at the axis on the right to know what their score is. So if we take Quebec, since it's right there, the student at the top in Quebec scores somewhere between 660 points and 670 points on the math test. If you take children at the bottom, the orange diamonds, they score more something like 440 points. So there is a large difference, and the difference is captured by the blue triangle. And then you need to look at the left axis here to see the gap. So the gap, if you look at the gap here, the blue line here, you see that the gap in Quebec is somewhere around 215 points. Now, what's interesting is to look at the fact that if you look at every single province, you move one by one, they are extremely similar. The gap is somewhere around 215 points and 230 points, but the reality here is there are enormous gaps in learning in Canada. And when you look at the 482 points here, why do I mark this? Because it's considered by PISA that if you reach 482 points, it means that you have the skills that you need to pursue in post-secondary education. So all these students here at the bottom in every single province, it's the same story, are not able to pursue in higher education. And this was true before the pandemic. So this is a picture of how Canada was doing prior to the pandemic. Then, if we look at what happened by socioeconomic status, so this is the gap, this was just showing the gap. Now let's look at what happens with socioeconomic status. So in PISA, there are a few measures of socioeconomic status. We use the measure that is based on parental occupation. Why do we do that? Because the education of the parent is poorly reported in PISA data by the students. So everything that is reported in PISA is reported by the child or the youth. So parental occupation is typically very well reported, while parental education is not as well reported. So using the parental occupation, we're able to rank children based on their parents' occupation into a socioeconomic index. And we compare children who are at the very top, whose parents' occupation puts them at the very top of the income distribution, and with the children at the very bottom of the parental economic, socioeconomic income distribution, the CES distribution, it will be easier. So when we compare children at the top with children at the bottom, what happens? So if you look here, the orange circle are children at the top, while the red circle are children at the bottom. So the Q5 children and the Q1 children. And what you see again is that there is a difference, but the difference is not as large. So if you refer to the difference on the left, you see the difference by socioeconomic status is somewhere around 60 to 70 points. So this represents more than 1 year of learning. It's about 1.5 year of learning. So it's not as large as the gap we observed before, but it's still a large gap. And what we see, if we look again at the 482 points here, is we see that in many provinces, children at the bottom of the socioeconomic status ranking do not have the skills required to pursue in higher education. So this is where we started before the pandemic hit. So knowing that, and also keep in mind that these are large differences that we should be worried about, but we're among the best, most equal country in the world. So in a sense, we could be pleased with that. We compare to Finland and Sweden, but we still have these children in red here who are lagging behind and who feel the pain of lagging behind. So even though we're at the best in terms of one of the best in terms of gaps, there are children who are behind, and it's a reality for them, and we should be concerned about that. So now, since we don't have data about how they did in the during the pandemic, what we did is we read a lot about what happens when you have learning interruptions. There are many strategies that have been used in the literature to see the impact of learning losses. There are papers that use summer learning losses. So they look at how children were doing just before the school closed, and they look at how they're doing when school reopened. There are papers that have used teacher strike, and in some countries, teacher strikes have lasted for more than 2 days. In some countries, it goes up to 70 days, 180 days, so it can be very long. some other papers have used regulation in school entry age to capture the difference in years of schooling. Other papers have used previous pandemics, like the polio pandemics. And finally, there are papers coming out using the actual COVID-19 pandemics, one in Belgium and one in Denmark, and both of which find that learning inequalities have increased and that students have lost some learning. And in both cases, if you read the paper in details, schools had only closed for 8 weeks. So very different from what we have experienced in Canada. So what we can gather from all of these papers, and we go into more details in our published paper, is that the average effect often masks important differences by SES. So what happens is that some paper will say, oh, well, it doesn't really matter if we close down schools, but what it hides is that children from higher socioeconomic background will gain, so they will keep on learning, while children from lower socioeconomic background will lose some ground. So when you average this together, it is true, it looks like a zero, or it's a bit negative, close to a zero. But when you are able to look into the details, you realize that in fact, inequalities have grown during that period. So in most papers that have been able to look at different profiles of children prior to the event that's used, they find that there are larger negative impact on low performing or low SES students. So in summary, using all this, what we are able to capture is that for a 3.2 month interruption, so the spring interruption, we expect that the overall learning will have decreased by about 1.4 months of schooling, so about 6 to 10 PISA points. And we expect that lower socioeconomic students will have lost 2 months, while high SES students will actually have been able to learn through virtual schooling, through their parents, through different tools that have been made accessible to them while the schools were closed. So this suggests that overall, we should expect an increase in inequalities of about 30% of the SES gap. So the SES gap was 60 to 70 points. So we should expect this number to increase by 30%. If nothing is done. So hopefully we will do something so it won't be as bad as what we're expecting. And then I would like to point out also that there's been a research by Anushek that estimates the impact of these learning losses on our economy. And according to his studies and then his methodology, he expects that Canada, and the number is specific to Canada, so it's not my estimate, it's his, well, the school closure alone in the spring will generate a loss of 1 to 2 billion losses in Canada over an 80-year period. So this represents, on average, as you average both numbers together, 1 year of GDP. So it's very significant, and it's only losses related to school closure. So no losses related to anything else that has happened in the economy. So what about long-term effects? So now I don't have the time, so in my phone just shut, so I don't know how much time I have still left, but maybe.
You have a couple of minutes.
Okay, perfect.
And while I'm interrupting you, I might as well just point out, you said 1 to 2 billion when you meant 1 to 2 trillion.
Oh, sorry, thank you so much. Yeah, it was 1,000 billion. Thank you so much. So, what are the possible long-term effects? So again, we rely on the literature. So we used the fact that we interrupted school by 70 days. So using that number, 70 days, we would expect high school graduation to decline by about 210 students per 1,000 students, university graduation to decline by 168 students per 1,000 students, salary losses over the lifetime would decrease by 2 to 3% annually. Total family income would also decrease by about 4% annually. There are some studies that show marriage downgrade for females. So it means that female married to partners who have a lower level of education. And finally, there are even studies that show the intergenerational effect of school interruption, and by showing that children of children who lived a school interruption have a higher probability of repeating a grade once they are in school. So these are important effect that we should keep in mind, and that we should keep in mind to make sure we put in place strategies to help children not experience this kind of situation. I'm going to skip my work on parental work and income inequalities, but I invite you to read our paper. I don't want to take too much time, so I'm just going to skip to my conclusion. So school closures have impact both on children and parents. Parents, I invite you to read our paper. And then children, I'm going to recap what I said. So it has an impact on learning inequalities. It increases inequalities. It has a larger impact on children from low socioeconomic background, and we should be worried about that. And in order to efficiently target and evaluate our intervention coming out of the pandemic, we need better data on children and youth. And what we advocate for is that the Canadian Survey on Children and Youth on health, the Canadian Health Survey of on Children and Youth, the CHEESY we called it, that was run in 2019, should be run again as soon as possible to allow us to identify the impact of the pandemic on children across Canada. And we would need a sample that's large enough to be able to look at the impact at the regional level, not just at the provincial level. So I would like to conclude by saying education should be considered an essential service. I'm not saying we should never close school, but we have to think about it when we decide to close school. And we should invest in micro data on children and youth. Thank you.
Thank you, Catherine. That was excellent. Thank you very, very much. And now we turn to Gaëlle Simard-Duplain.
I think we should take questions first.
Are we gonna do it that way? I'm sorry, yeah. I didn't realize. We're gonna do first questions on Catherine, and then we're going to move on. Do you have some questions there?
Yeah, we do. So I'm gonna go through the questions, and thank you so much for the presentation. It was really interesting. So the first question is, the presentation focused mostly on negative impacts on students and learning. Do you think that there are any positive impacts?
On students and learning, no. There might be positive impact in families in which the environment is positive. There's probably bonding that has happened between parents since they spend so much time together during this pandemic. But I'm most concerned about vulnerable children, if I'm honest. I think that children in families in which things are generally fairly smooth are doing quite well. My concern is more about vulnerable children and family environment in which things are not going so smoothly.
Okay, great. So the next question is, when comparing across sources of variation, so summer break, school start age, polio pandemic, are there different implications for outcomes at the low SES end, i.e. should we expect school closures that are associated with significant life disruptions to have more negative effects for students with less resources?
Yes, it's a good question. Actually, most of the literature looks at school interruption that don't have the kind of disruption that we have lived through. So if you think about teacher strikes, the family environment is not as changed as what we have experienced in the last year. If you think about summer learning losses, life is typically good in the summer, so it's not the same kind of losses you would have. If you think about the strategy that uses differences in school starting age, again, it's business as usual. So it's really there's really not that many studies that used a pandemic or something similar, but the studies that are coming out using this actual pandemic find very similar results to what our estimate was back in the summer. So we're pretty confident that, yes, life is tougher, so it can have a larger impact, but at the same time, we have technology that didn't exist when most of these studies were done. So there was some virtual schooling, there were some support provided by teachers to various degrees across the country. So we think our estimate is probably fairly coherent and in line with what we are seeing coming out of other research from other countries.
Okay, that's great. So next question is, how should we think about your results given that this 3.2 month interruption was followed by 2 months of summer?
Well, it's a good question. If if there is an accumulation of learning losses, so if the fact that you've lost ground makes you lose even more ground in the summer, we could have underestimated our impact because we didn't take into account the summer. We thought, well, summer happens every year. So if the fact that if the losses increase as time increase, if you want, then our estimate is too conservative. If losses are fairly linear in terms of month loss, then our estimate is correct. Or as good as it can be, let's be precise.
Okay, sounds good. Next question, do you have any thoughts on whether the effects will be more or less severe when some schools were opening and closing shorter periods, i.e. was there was exposure in specific schools?
That's a very good question for which I don't have answers, but at the same time, if I use studies that have been done by Canadians on smaller teacher strike, so of about 10 days, so teacher strike of about 10 days do have an impact. So they did detect an impact of teacher strike, even if they were fairly short. One day doesn't really matter, but when it starts to be 10 days, it starts to matter. Having said that, again, these studies were done in a context where there was no virtual schooling. So at the moment when we close school, there is some schooling going on. And again, to various degree, in more well-off neighborhoods, probably easier. In families where internet connections are better, more computers, it's easier to follow. In families in which nobody has a computer and we're following classes on a cell phone, which happened to one of my students, it's harder. So these interruptions will likely affect inequality just because access to technology is not the same. And depending on the age of the child, delivering content using virtual schooling is not as efficient.
Okay, so maybe we'll take one more. And then we'll move on to Gaëlle's presentation. So does immigrant status of the students a significant factor in this study or have a significant effect in this study?
It's actually a very good question. We did not measure measure differences by the background of the students. And we don't, when we read the literature, very few papers were measuring the impact of closures depending on the origin, country of origin of the student. So I kind of remember one or two papers, but I don't remember the numbers off the top of my head. So we did not feel comfortable making a statement on this since we did not have information. Plus some of the numbers sometimes come from the US where the differences in socioeconomic status are more tightly linked with your country or your ethnicity. So they might not have been as relevant for Canada. So given the lack of information, we didn't estimate this by ethnicity.
Okay, thank you. So I think that's all the time we have for taking questions up live. I don't know, Catherine, do you want to answer some questions by typing the answers to the questions if you are able to see them?
Oh, yeah, I can do that. But yes, I can do that. I'll just go out of my full screen mode and stop sharing. Thank you so much.
Thank you. So now we're moving on to Gaëlle.
Just give me 1 second to share.
Yep.
There we go. Hi, so thanks for having me today. In the work that I'm presenting, my co-authors and I have looked at the immediate economic importance of in-person K-12 schooling. And I'm really excited for this opportunity to present some of our findings, so thanks again for having me. So we know that schools play a crucial role in the health and well-being of children and their families. So we've seen some examples of that just now. And what we've wanted to do is we've wanted to quantify the immediate economic importance of K-12 schooling. So I emphasize immediate because, of course, education is an investment in the future skills of children. But it's also really important from an economic standpoint today because it allows parents to supply work and to earn income. And I think that this is really obvious to parents that have gone through this pandemic, but it's not necessarily captured by typical measures of the economic importance of different sectors of the economy. And it means that we run the risk of overlooking some of that importance when we talk about the role of schools at large in society and in the economy. So what we do in this paper is we start from two standard measures of economic importance that I'm going to present in a few seconds, and then we extend those measures to account for the labor-availing role of education. And what I'm going to show you is that as you may apprehend, K-12 education is essential to the functioning of the economy. So we use two measures of economic importance. The first one is size. So we're going to use specifically the fraction of total GDP that is produced by a sector. And our second measure is a measure of centrality. So essentially, how important that sector is to the functioning of the rest of the economy. So how essential it is. So when we look at the economy, we see that some sectors produce mostly for final demand. And so if we were to shut down that sector, it would matter for GDP, but you would see the rest of the economy that keeps functioning as normal. Whereas some sectors produce inputs that are used by other sectors in the economy. And so if we were to shut down those sectors, we would find that there's entire parts of the economy that no longer can operate. And so these are very central sectors. And we can push that even further. So we have sectors that produce inputs for other sectors, which themselves in turn produce inputs for other sectors. And so the more deeply embedded a sector is in the economy, the more central it's going to be, the more important it is for the functioning of the rest of the economy. And both of these measures capture the economic importance of a sector, but they capture different aspects of that importance. And as it turns out, when we conventionally measure the K-12 education system, it is neither large nor central. And intuitively, you can see why that may be the case, right? So most of the output of the K-12 system is in the form of wages paid to teachers, to administrators, and to other people who work in K-12 education. And so it's fairly small. It's also not very central because K-12 educators don't typically supply their services to other sectors of the economy. So it's a very peripheral sector of the economy when we conventionally measure it. But of course, what these measures miss is that K-12 or in-person schooling allows parents to supply work to the economy. And parents are a big part of the economy. And so depending on which sector we consider, 6 to 23% of work hours supplied are supplied by parents. And they're supplied by what we're going to call workers needing childcare. So it's a subset of parents for whom childcare obligations can interfere with their ability to supply work. And so we want to address this. We want to recalculate our measures of economic importance while taking into account this labor availing effect of K-12 education. And so to do this, to formalize this intuition I've just given you and to extend our two measures of economic importance, we're going to model a new sector that produces the labor of workers needing childcare, right? So of parents, essentially. And accounting for this new sector is going to allow us to revise our measures of size and centrality of K-12 education and to really reflect the important role it plays in the economy in terms of allowing parents to participate essentially in the economy. And so to measure the size of the workers needing childcare sector, what we do is we go to each other sector of the economy and we calculate the proportion of value added, so the proportion of their contribution to GDP that is attributable to labor income. And then in turn, the proportion of that labor income that is attributable to workers needing childcare. And so we do this for every sector. We sum this across all sectors, and that gives us the size of the workers needing childcare sector. And we do something similar for the centrality measure. So we assume that the workers needing childcare sector uses all of the output from the in-person K-12 education sector to produce workers needing childcare labor, and that this labor is in turn supplied to all sectors of the economy. So essentially, we've defined the position of this new artificial sector, the workers needing childcare sector, in the structure, in the network of the economy. To do these calculations, we use two data sources. So we use the Canadian symmetric input-output tables from 2015. The reason we use 2015 is because that's what was the most up-to-date version at the time that we wrote the paper. So that's what gives us, for each sector of the economy, input usage, output, labor income, and value added. And then we also use the 2016 census from which we get the proportion of labor income that is attributable to workers needing childcare. And we play with the definition of workers needing childcare. So we recognize that not all parents are going to be hindered in their ability to work if the schools are closed. And so our benchmark definition of workers needing childcare is we consider three types of families. So for we're going to treat all lone parents as workers needing childcare. We're going to treat no parent in two parent, one earner families as a worker needing childcare. So we assume, right, that all childcare is provided by the non-working parent. And then in two parents, two earners families, we're going to treat half of each parent as a worker needing childcare. And we assume that workers needing childcare cannot work because they're providing care. And of course, these are big assumptions. They don't take in consideration how parents actually organize family responsibilities. This is just what we use as a benchmark. In the paper, we actually do look at other alternatives of the definition, and we find that our results qualitatively don't change. We do find differences quantitatively, but our main conclusion of the paper will not be affected by how we define workers needing childcare. So let me show you some results. So for the size, so remember, so we have this new sector, we calculate the size of that new sector, and it's going to allow us to revise our calculation of the size of the K-12 sector, which is ultimately our goal. And so the figure here essentially illustrates how we do all this for the size measure. So every bar represents a sector of the economy. And then the height of each bar is going to represent the share of total GDP that is attributable to that sector. So if you look, for example, at the first bar here, you see that the management sector is the smallest sector of the economy. It accounts for less than 1% of total GDP. In comparison, real estate here at the right is the largest sector of the economy. It accounts for roughly 13% of total GDP. And you can see that educational services is here. So educational services includes both K-12 education and other levels, so college and university and other such things. So the whole of educational services accounts for a little over 5% of GDP. And then the orange section is really the part that comes from K-12. So it's less than 3% of the economy. So as I mentioned, as conventionally measured, K-12 is very small. So what we do, as I described, is that we go to each non-education sector or even the education sector. And then we ask, what is the portion of their GDP contribution that comes from labor? And what is the proportion of the labor income that comes from workers needing childcare? And so that would be the tiny blue section of each bar. And so we sum those blue portions across all sectors, and that gives us the total contribution of workers needing childcare in the economy. And so we've reproduced the summed portion of all of this here. So this would be the total contribution of workers needing childcare, which is what we call the indirect contribution of K-12 education, right? So K-12 education enables those workers to work. And so that's the indirect contribution of the K-12 sector and amounts to about 8.5%. And then we, of course, have the direct contribution of K-12, which is just this section here that we've translated here. And so if we account for this conceptually new sector, this workers needing childcare sector, we find that the extended measure of the size of K-12 gives us 11.5% in terms of its contribution to GDP. And that makes K-12 education the second largest sector in the economy. Right, so we went from a contribution of less than 3% to a contribution that places it second only to real estate. So it makes it the second most important sector. And as I mentioned, we do allow for different definitions of workers needing childcare. So we've looked at a number of them in the paper. One of the ones that we considered is assuming that the worker that needs childcare in two-parent, two-earner families is the low earner. And so that decreases the importance of the workers needing childcare sector, and it makes it the third most important sector, right? So it does affect our results quantitatively, but we still conclude that accounting for the labor availing effect of K-12 education really emphasizes how important that sector is in the economy. And so we come to a similar conclusion when you look at centrality. So here you have a heuristic representation of our centrality measure. So if you look at the left panel, you have the representation of our standard measure of centrality. And so every bubble represents a sector, and then the arrows represent the input and output flows from one sector to the other. And so you can see that K-12 schooling, as I mentioned, when it's conventionally measured, isn't very important. And the reason why that is because the services of teachers, of educators, are not really sold, are not typically sold to other sectors. And so it's a sector that really remains on the periphery of the economy because it really just produces for final demand. And so it does use, some of its inputs come from other sectors. And so you can see that here, for instance, with the, you know, real estate, is going to provide some of the inputs that go into K-12 schooling, but it really doesn't, it's not very central in the network of economic activity. However, when we introduce this new sector, this workers needing childcare sector, that's a sector that purchases all of the output of K-12 schooling and then supplies to all of the other sectors. So our new sector is itself very central, right? Because it purchases inputs, but also supplies the input that is used in the production of many other sectors. And the fact that the workers needing childcare is so central, it also makes the K-12 schooling so central, because for the workers needing childcare sector to function and to supply its labor to other sectors, it relies on the output of the K-12 schooling sector. So accounting for that labor availing effect, again, really highlights the true position that K-12 schooling has in the network of economic activity. And so that's what you can see here. So this is these are our actual results for centrality. So if you look again at the left panel, you can see that our measure of centrality is an index that runs from 0 to 100. And so 0 is the least central, completely on the periphery. 100 is the most central sector. And this is a cumulative distribution function. And so as conventionally measured, K-12 schooling ranks 82nd out of the 98 sectors that are included in this picture. So every tiny triangle is a sector, and K-12 schooling is here. Right, so K-12 schooling is more central than only about 16% of the sectors that are considered. So again, on the periphery of the network. When you consider our extended measure of centrality, you can see that K-12 schooling moves to the first position. So it is the most central sector in the economy when we take in consideration the fact that it is essential to supply, it is essential for our artificial workers needing childcare sector to function. Formally modeling this role highlights the importance of K-12 schooling for all of the economy to function. And as I mentioned, we do play around with some of the assumptions and some of the definitions. And so by our most conservative of measures, we rank K-12 schooling at least in 13th out of 98 sectors, right? So even by the most conservative measure, K-12 schooling moves from being 82nd out of 98 to 13th, and potentially, we believe, more likely at the top of the distribution. And so just to conclude, in-person K-12 education is essential in allowing parents to work. And that role is essentially overlooked by conventional measures of the importance of different sectors of the economy to the functioning of the economy. So when we account for this role, we find that our measure of the contribution of K-12 to GDP goes from less than 3% to 11.5%. And that number does change a little bit when we play with the definition of workers needing childcare, but it's always much higher than 3%. And similarly, when we look at centrality, so we find that K-12 education is, by our favorite estimate, is the most central sector of the economy, but at least 13th out of 98 sectors that we consider. And of course, this adds to the already multifaceted role of education, and fully understanding all of the aspects, so the short-term and the longer-term aspects, and the economic and the non-economic aspects of the role of education, is important when we decide and how we decide to keep schools open. It's also important as we're moving along with this vaccination in terms of determining the priority of school teachers in receiving vaccines. So that's it for me for today. Thank you very much, and I look forward to your questions.
Thank you so much, Gaëlle. This was a very interesting presentation. And I think we should just leave a moment for questions to come in, unless Catherine or Mike have any questions. Go ahead.
Yeah, so I thought I might ask a question. Gaëlle, I forget whether there's a substitution margin. If parents can't show up for work, do non-parents supply more labor?
So we've assumed that, so we've been very agnostic about how parents negotiate that. So we've essentially assumed we've designated a parent in a two-parent, two-earner household that would be the non-working parent. And if that person doesn't work, nothing else happens in the household. So we just assume that person doesn't work, we shut that down. And so, of course, it would be very interesting if we'd properly modeled all of those dynamics at the household level, but we haven't.
No, but what I'm thinking of is at the firm level, at the production level, are firms able to fill in the shortfall in the model?
So I imagine that's how it happens in reality, but again, we haven't been into those details.
But the opposite could also happen. The fact that someone is not there could affect the work of someone who's still there.
Right.
Absolutely. So yeah.
It could go in both directions.
Right. And I was thinking about that. I mean, 98 sectors is a ton of sectors that I wouldn't suggest you try anymore. But there's a sense in which it probably still underestimates the problem, because you can have one little tiny sector that supplies, a particular kind of bolts. And if you don't have those kind of bolts, you can't build the building, right?
And so, yeah, and that is taken in consideration to, in the centrality measure, it captures the fact that, again, the deeper you are in that network, so if you're supplying to someone who supplies to someone else who supplies to someone else, all of these repercussions are going to be accounted for in the centrality measure, which is why it's such an interesting measure.
I think we have some questions rolling in from the audience as well now. In your paper's alternative measures, do you consider that some jobs and industries can become work from home jobs and industries more easily than others?
So what we did do is our benchmark measure assumes that people do not work when they're workers needing childcare. But of course, that's not what we've seen, right? Parents have adapted in all sorts of ways. But we do still believe that productivity has been affected. So we do have an estimate that assumes that instead of being completely shut down, productivity is shut down by half. I can't actually exactly remember the number off the top of my head, but I think we get that the size of the sector goes from 11.5%, which is our benchmark, to roughly 7%. So still, you know, well over double what it is as conventionally measured. And so there is indeed, like, this is an excellent question in that there is indeed a sense in which the extent to which people are able to work from home is going to affect the estimate. But we still think there's probably an impact on productivity.
Okay, great. So there's a question from someone here that says, I think you said this doesn't matter for your conclusions, but how much does the impact change if you were to only consider children younger than 12 as needing care?
So, I mean, I don't think we've ever done it for only that that subset. So we use children from 5 to 17. Our reasoning for doing that is because there's lots of places where you actually can't leave a child, you know, a 14-year-old at home alone. And so we thought this was a reasonable assumption. And I don't know how it's split in terms of, you know, how many parents of children, 12 and less don't have children older and vice versa. So it would affect the results. It would be less, fewer parents most likely, but I don't know exactly to what extent.
Okay. And can this methodology be applied to assessing the importance of childcare younger than kindergarten? If so, how?
So I think that, I think the going the other way around is a bit complex, and that you would have to make some assumptions about who are the parents of younger children who would join the workforce if there was childcare available to them. But I think you can get some ideas of that that response margin from places like Quebec, where we've seen what happens to employment when you introduce childcare. So I think you could do something similar, but again, you'd have to make assumptions about who are the parents that are joining the workforce if you introduce more childcare.
Okay, great. You acknowledged some strong assumptions about how families adjust labor supply when K to 12 is shut down, and that they don't affect the results qualitatively. But how much do they affect them quantitatively, and how much smaller is the orange K to 12 circle?
Yeah, absolutely. So, I think one of the things I haven't mentioned that we do touch upon in the paper is that, these are aggregate results, but there are important distributional consequences of closing schools. And that's a little bit what we were trying to get at when we looked at this alternative definition that uses the lower earner. And so, of course, if to the extent that, and I'm not saying that's what everyone does, or that's an adequate representation of how families are organizing. But if for instance you assume that the lower earner is the one who leaves work, necessarily by construction the impact is smaller. And so I think that So the orange portion that the person is talking about, so the direct contribution of K to 12 is not affected, because this is the actual contribution of K to 12 in the economy. The impact of the workers needing childcare sector is smaller. And I think, if I remember correctly, the extended contribution of K to 12 goes from 11.5% to 8.5%. So it is smaller, and it is coming from the fact that now the person who's not at work was already earning less to start with. You can start imagining what happens if you introduce more complex versions of how families are adapting to this, depending on what margin they're adapting on.
Okay, oh, great. So maybe we'll take one more. I just want to make sure I'm going in sequence here. Is there a way to also account for the impact of school closures on skills of individuals entering economy sectors? Graduates of 2020 and 2021 may not have entered the sectors that they would have if their skills were not undercut by the closures.
I mean, absolutely. This is a whole other ball game. And we've really focused on, you know, I think there's a good sense, and Catherine has talked about some of those papers, that, you know, the missed school today is going to have long-term impacts. We imagine it's going to have long-term impacts on skill development for children. We haven't looked at that at all. We're really just talking about the ability of parents today to take part in work.
Okay, I think this is all the time that we have, unfortunately, to take more questions for Catherine or for Gaëlle. And it's been a pleasure having you both on here. And thank you so much, Mike, also for joining us. And thank you for your presentations. And thank you, everybody, for attending this webinar. And I hope to see you next time.
Okay, Perry, and I would just like to thank you and Chloe for all your work on this and organizing. And of course, our excellent speakers, Catherine and Gaëlle, really great presentations, and how important they showed that the education sector is in our economy in different ways, and how vital it is. And also the importance of data, which of course is what the Canadian Research Data Center Network is all about.
Thank you so much.
Thank you.
Bye.
Bye.